We serve a risen Savior.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. This morning we're going to be coming from Luke, the 14th chapter, beginning with the 25th verse, going to the 30th verse. Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke. chapter 14 of Luke, it begins that Jesus, when Jesus had a Pharisee's house for dinner on the Sabbath day. And this time, Jesus asked them a question. He asked them, was it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? And they had no answer. Meanwhile, there was a man there in need of healing, and Jesus did heal him. You see, the Pharisees were constantly putting the law in front of Jesus, daring him to break it. They were more worried about the letter of the law than the intent of the law. And Jesus had come to fulfill the law, and with that fulfillment, he also brought mercy and grace. As he so often did, Jesus used this time as a teaching opportunity. He sat back at the house and he watched what the Pharisees were doing. You can learn a lot by just watching.
Amen.
Jesus taught them about humility when they picked the positions of honor at the table. He told them about generosity and giving without the expectation of getting back from the person that you give to, but instead getting your reward in heaven. Then Jesus gave a parable or a story about a great banquet a man was giving and how in the end he had his servants go out into the highways and the byways and invite whoever they saw to come to the feast when the invited guests had excuses as to why they couldn't come and refuse the invitation. Instead of letting the food go to waste, he made it available to all. This is what God has done. The Jews were his chosen people. But when Jesus came, he expanded that invitation to the Gentiles, and now salvation is available to whosoever will come. It's not about your status in life, your position at the job, or even if you have a job. It's not about how much money you have or how many people know your name. The feast has been prepared and you are invited.
Amen.
Will you accept the invitation, or is there an excuse why you can't come right now? What do you have to do that's more important than your salvation? That's more important than your very soul? And then we get to today's text. In some Bible translations, there are topic titles, and this one is titled, The Cost of Being a Disciple.
All right.
As I said before, there is a cost associated with everything you do. Nothing in life is free. Even when you accept Christ, you have a responsibility that comes with that decision. Because as soon as you make that decision, the fight for your life, your health, your sanity, even your very soul begins.
Right.
You see, before you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, the enemy had you.
That's right.
You were not a threat to his plan. Therefore, he left you alone. When someone is already on your team, you don't have to court or convince them to be a part of your team. But when you receive your salvation and start working in the kingdom of God, you are now Satan's enemy, and he's going to come after you. Good as lazy. In whatever way he can to get you to stop witnessing for Christ. You see, he will let you read your Bible. He'll even let you pray if you're praying those meet my eye prayers, because that's not affecting his kingdom. But when you follow the last command that Jesus gave, to go ye therefore and make disciples, now you're messing with his turf, and he's not going to stand idly by while you do it. Jesus typically had large crowds following him for all different reasons. It's the same today. When people come to church, there are those who don't know or fail to recognize the church is the people, not the building. That's why we can have services in our home, in the storefront, on a street corner, or in a park, and it would still be a church. Amen. Turn my volume down. Worship is not about a building. It's about the heart of the person standing before the Lord. We must always remember that. It's not what we look like, how we dress, or how many amens, thank you Jesuses, and hallelujahs we say that make us Christians. It's our obedience to the word of God. It's the love we have one for another. When you love God, when you are a Christian, there is some evidence in your life, and it's not the size of the cross hanging from your neck. So when you change teams, the enemy comes after you. There must be a conscious decision to change teams, because we're all born Amen? He is the only begotten Son of God, and he said, no man comes to the Father but by me. So when you accept Christ, you have changed teams. You are now Satan's enemy, and he's going to come after you in whatever way he can to get you to stop. Jesus says, if you're not willing to hate your father, mother, wife, and children, brothers and sisters, even your own life, you cannot be his disciples. Does this mean you must walk away from all these people to receive Christ? Maybe. Better yet, invite them to come with you. If they're not already there, because maybe mama or daddy, brother or sister prayed you in, it means that Christ must mean more to you than anything or anyone else. He has to be number one in your life, even more than you. It means you're all in. And any of those people tell you things that are contrary to the word of God and the mission he's given you, you have to be willing to walk away from them. You have to understand that this is a serious battle we're in for the very lives and souls of people. It's not a time to be playing around or getting distracted by those in your inner circle, including yourself. You have the power to talk yourself in or out of many things, and your body will respond. We all have a cross to carry, a burden to bear. There is none perfect, no, not one. Your cross is yours, and no one else can carry it for you. From the youngest to the oldest, we all have our own burden to bear. But here's the good news. Jesus said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For my yoke is easy and my burdens are light. Jesus took your burdens when he went to the cross. Stop taking them back. Stop accepting sickness. Stop speaking death into your situation. Stop letting others tell you who you are. Instead, speak health, wealth, and life into your situation. Yeah. Speak the promises of God over your life. Amen. Speak those things that are not as though they were, and watch God make it happen.
Watch God.
I'm not talking about a name it and claim it, self-centered prosperity preaching. I'm talking about the God who shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. The God who knows what you need before you even speak it. The God who said no good thing will he withhold from us. The God who has given all, including his only begotten Son, for you, for your sake, for your healing, for your righteousness, for your very soul, while you were yet sinners.
Yes,
now, who wouldn't love a God like that? Who wouldn't leave all for a God like that? That's the kind of God I'm asking you to serve. One that first loved you. One that gave to you first. One that made the first move. Now it's your turn. Don't look at your neighbor's cross and think they have it easy. Just maybe the yoke they have is the one that Jesus gave, and that same one that's available to you. God's not a respecter of persons. What he did for your brother, what he did for your sister, your mother, your father, he'll do for you.
All right.
Try him and see, won't he do it? Come on now, won't he do it?
Yes.
How many of you have tried him for yourself?
Amen.
How many of you have a testimony about the goodness of the Lord? If they added a 67th book to the Bible that was your story, how long would it be? By word count, would it be like the third chapter of John 3, the shortest book in the Bible? Or would it be like Jeremiah, the longest book in the Bible? Are you still building your book? If you're alive, there's still time.
All right.
Now it's time to do some figuring. There is a cost, and sometimes the price is high. If you are the first in your family to accept Christ, you may lose your whole family and feel all alone.
That's right.
But can I tell you something?
Come on.
The God we serve is worth that and so much more. What tower are you trying to build? Can you afford it mentally, physically, and emotionally? You see, accepting that Jesus died so we can have eternal life, walking down the aisle, praying a prayer of salvation, accepting Jesus as Lord of your life, well, that's free. It doesn't cost you a thing. You don't have to put an offering in the plate before you can do that. But after this, after you say yes to the Lord,
right,
after you turn your life over to Christ, what does that really mean? Well, as disciples of Christ, and a disciple is a follower, it means we look like Christ in what we say and do. It means it's no longer about what we think
or how we would handle a situation. It's about what was a catchy thing to say a few years ago. There were bracelets and necklaces and t-shirts with the initials WWJD, which meant what would Jesus do? And if what Jesus would do is different from what you would do, go with his response. You see, your response stems from the flesh rather than from the spirit. Mm-hmm. Until you get to a place where you are no longer speaking from your flesh, where you can't lay down your religion, where you have no other opinion than the word of God. When you know and can accept this, you have counted the cost to build the tower.
All right. Mm-hmm.
You have determined what you will gain is more than what you'll give up. You've determined you have the stamina to run the race to the very end. That's not how fast you're running. That is about the cost. How much are you picking up along the way?
Come on now.
You've determined you have the stamina to run the race to the very end.
Yes.
That is not how fast you're running that counts. It's
That's
about
right.
how much you're picking up along the way.
Come on.
Along the way, did you pick up that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life? Along the way, did you pick up that he was wounded for your transgressions? He was bruised for your iniquities, that the chastisement of your peace was upon him, and by his stripes you were healed? Along the way, did you pick up that obedience is better than sacrifice?
Come on now.
Along the way, did you pick up that Christ came that you might have life and life more abundantly?
Yes.
Along the way, did you pick up that he will never leave you nor forsake you? You don't want to go too fast, or you might miss that he wants to give you exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think, according to the power that works in you. If you go too fast, you might miss that God is a protector and a provider.
Yes.
If you go too fast, you might miss that God throws your sins into the sea of forgetfulness
yes.
and remembers them no more. If you go too fast, you might miss that God is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Yes.
If you go too fast, you might miss that God wants to bless you so yes. you can bless others.
All right.
If you go too fast, you might miss that God said your children's children shall be blessed.
Come on, man.
If you go too fast, you might miss that if you pay your tithe, God will open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. You won't have enough room to receive it.
Preach.
If you go too fast, you might miss the blessing of the Lord that brings wealth, and he adds no trouble to it. So if you went out and got something and you can't pay for it, or it's nothing but trouble, or he's beating you, or she's talking you down and not encouraging you,
yes.
that's not from God, because his blessings add no trouble. Slow down, because you don't want to miss that you'll be even more blessed if you hear the word of God and put it into practice.
Yes.
Slow down so you'll know that blessed Slow is down. The man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him.
Slow down
so you'll know that the Lord chastens those whom he loves.
Yes.
He doesn't want you going in the wrong direction, and the last thing you want God to do is turn you over to a reprobate mind.
Come on,
you see, if you insist on having your way, God is not going to stop you. He'll let you have it. But there are consequences for your actions, so choose carefully. You need to count the cost.
That's right.
Slow down so you'll know that those who fear or reverence the Lord will be blessed.
Yes.
Slow down so you'll know that those who keep the Lord's commands will be blessed.
Yes.
You've got to slow down sometimes, because the race is not given to the swift nor to the strong,
yes.
but to he who endures to the end.
Endure.
You got to finish the race. You don't have to be first, because the word of God also says the last shall be first
yes.
and the first shall be last. For many
Amen.
Be called, but few are chosen.
Amen.
I submit to you, don't worry about where you finish.
Uh-huh.
Just finish.
Finish.
There's a room. There is room at the cross for you.
Finish strong.
Right.
Your foundation is important. Your foundation should be Jesus Christ.
That's right.
But your building shouldn't stop there. The person who stops there is the one who gets all they can, cans all they get, then sits on the can.
Come on, man.
Give and it will come back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. You can't receive with a closed fist. Open your hand and let some things go.
Come on, man.
Bless others and the Lord will bless you.
Yeah.
You can't beat God-giving, so yes, always be ready to give. Try him and see. All the promises of God are yea and amen.
Amen.
If God said it, it's done. But you have a part to do. God has given you all you need to do what he's called you to do.
That's right.
Now the rest is up to you. That gift he's placed in you, it's up to you to nurture and develop and use it for the edification of the saints and the glory of God.
Uh-huh.
I heard a story about a man who, when he was a boy, he and his siblings would help their mother in their cleaning business.
Uh-huh.
His job was to clean the bathrooms, and when there was a particularly dirty one, she would give him Ajax to clean with.
Ajax.
He would sprinkle some Ajax on the dirty tub, and then he would just rinse it away. Then he would proclaim to his mother what she gave him didn't work, to which she responded, "What I gave you does work, if you make it work."
Come on now.
You have to put some elbow grease to it, and it will work.
Uh-huh.
The ability God has given you, you have to be willing to put some elbow grease into it to make it work.
Yeah.
You have to be willing to take time, give of your time to rehearse. You have to be willing to give of your time to witness. You have to be willing to give of your time to submit to training. You see, it's not always about money.
Uh-huh.
Stewardship is about time, it's about talent, it's about time, and it's about resources.
Yeah, yeah.
What has God given to you that you need to give back to him? What has God given you that you need to spend time practicing to perfect it? What has God given you that you need to change your schedule and sacrifice your desire to do what he desires?
Yeah.
Jesus gave us the perfect example of doing the will of the Father when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane when he prayed to the Father. The human part of him prayed, "Lord, if it be thine will, remove this cup from me." But the obedient part of him finished with, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine will be done."
Yeah.
It was then, has always been, and will always be about the will of the Father.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus laid his life down for your sins and mine. He counted the cost and determined he loved you this much, and he stretched his arms and died. He paid the ultimate price for our sins. You see, sin required a blood sacrifice, and the blood of animals just wasn't enough. It took the very Son of God to pay the debt once and for all.
Yes.
Christ said, "You were worth his life," and he willingly gave it.
Wow.
He gave you a firm foundation to build on. Don't worry about what your haters might say. Let your haters propel you to the next level in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
You will never please everyone, so don't drive yourself crazy trying.
Amen.
You tell your mother, father, husband, wife, sister, brother, children, or friends what thus saith the Lord.
Yes.
Let your light show shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father in heaven.
Yes.
And remember, it's not now, never has been, and never will be about you. And God will take care of you.
Amen.
What are you doing?
Amen.
Not what are you going to do, but what are you doing to advance and enhance the kingdom of God? Are you doing your part? If your answer is nothing, today is a perfect day to start.
Yes, yes.
And if you haven't yet given your life to Christ, that is the perfect and only place to start. There's a cost for everything we do, but your sin debt has been paid in full.
Praise
with the blood of Jesus.
Thank
the
you.
Foundation is laid, and Jesus is waiting with open arms for you.
Okay.
Let today be the first day of the rest of your life. Let today be the day you recognize that the best is yet to come.
Yes,
and you start walking in your promises. This thing is personal. This thing is personal.
Yes, it is.
The doors of the church are open.
Amen.
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 If you have not made Christ your personal Lord and Savior, right now is a good time.
A good time.
Today is a good day.
Yes.
Amen.